Good evening, Nerd Fam, and welcome back to beautiful Bavaria for the last time here, closing out Celosphere in Munich, Germany. My name is Savannah Peterson, joined by my two favorite analysts on the whole planet, Rob Strechay and George Gilbert. Rob and George, thank you so much for taking the time to close out the show with me today.
I'm excited too. I'm excited to have George here. I mean, you've been buried in like meetings and one-on-ones and roundtables, and so excited to have you on here to kind of contribute back in a little bit on what you've seeing.
Well, so, George, just to get us started, what stood out to you the most this week?
Well, it's like a continuation of what I saw last year, which is, I'm going to betray my age a little bit, but I told the Celonis folks that this feels very much like SAP did in early to mid 90s when it was taking off. And like SAP was the first real enterprise application. And Celonis is the first real application that aspires to integrate the enterprise end to end. I mean, before you talk about technology and announcements, like for 60 years, we've never really done anything different other than build more and more silos, you know? And so it was like craft work. You know, everyone worked around their application, and then humans were the sneaker net between applications. And the whole idea of Celonis is to put a layer above that to integrate things and manage processes end to end. And it so happens that when agents came along, they don't work in silos. I mean, if you work with them in silos, it's like paving cow paths. There's not a lot of value in that. And so just the way the smartphone really accelerated the rise of the cloud, agents are going to accelerate the rise of the digital twin, because they're only useful when they can see across the enterprise. My favorite analogy is, you know, we had self-driving cars in the desert 30 years ago, but if you wanted them to work in cities and on highways with other self-driving cars and with other human-driven cars and with pedestrians, you would have needed like a four-dimensional dynamic map. This is, agents need the four-dimensional dynamic map. That's what Celonis is. So that's the big picture.
What do you think has changed the most in terms of their evolution between 2025 when we were here last year and today?
So they made this big transition. It was pretty profound transition where the technical term is object-centric process mining, but that's where an object like a customer or a sales order can participate in many different processes. And that's crucial for sort of busting out of these silos.
And that was when they brought out the process intelligence graph last year, or as they call it, the pig. So
the supporting technologies are like now GA.
Right.
And so the process intelligence platform now lets you sort of analyze, design and operate processes.
Right.
And it's, you know, most other competitors, you know, they have dashboards, like pretty pictures of your processes, but these now actually, you can analyze how process works, you can design how it should work. You know, the analyze part is like where the kinks, you know, then there's the design how it should work, and then put it into operation. And then that's the map that the agent needs, or that the team of agent needs.
So, I mean, even when we were talking to Deutsche Telekom earlier, and they tried to use Celonis back in 2021, and it actually, they couldn't, because it was use case based, and they needed for it to be object based.
Yeah.
And they even talked about this, and it would seem that, you know, we talk about this all the time, is that it's that semantic and the business semantics going back in. Is that what you heard this week as well?
Yes, because that is what the process intelligence graph is. It's like our favorite business is, you know, the data platform guys, we love those guys, but they have like essentially records that are individual events or snapshots of entities, but then when you group them all together and you add all this contextual data, that's when you get the process map. And that's the new layer above that data platform. And you know, there was one of the sort of kinks in the older version was it was difficult to get data out of the legacy systems, and so they have this new technology called Data Core, which is built on the, or you guys probably have talked about this, it's built on now, you know, the data lake architecture, so it's no longer got an on-prem database as its engine, so more scalable, and then it can take data from, you know, Databricks or Microsoft Fabric, eventually Snowflake, and it pulls that into the graph, so it's now much easier to get, you know, your operational data into the graph, but then you can send the data back out.
Right.
And so it's a good citizen for IT.
So one question to you, because I think what
I get asked a question?
You're going to get a question.
That's fun, I never get a question.
So I think because you're talking about the zero ETL, I think one of the things I'm interested, because we were talking to a lot of these organizations about, and you brought it up a lot, is that how is it really impacting the people aspect mm-hmm. of it? So what was it, some of the learnings that you heard over this 2 days of and a ton of interviews?
It's a great question, Rob, and I think it's a real blind spot in our industry a lot because people over-index on the tech and the tooling and the specs. None of that matters if somebody doesn't adopt it. And I thought, and when we're talking about process mining, I say this with love, not everybody is initially very comfortable with activities and their actions being tracked at the granular level because a lot of the software that existed in this category before was keystrokes, time on web pages. It was very over the shoulder, is my employee really working? Not actually looking at their efficacy, but just looking at their time in a certain place. And what I've found and very enlightening in talking to so many of Celonis' customers is the way that they've managed to get cultural buy-in. And I think that's part of why Celonis is having so much success. And so what they've done is they've focused on very specific use cases, figured out to achieve real success.
Yeah.
10x things, or you know, a very dramatic amount of savings, or with just those 11 champions, $8 billion in value realized. But when a team sees that this is about business outcomes,
right,
not about individual contributor comparison, which is how I think most people assume this type of software is going to work or these layers are going to work, you get an entirely different attitude. And it was fun. I'm just thinking of the conversation we had with Janet from the state of Oklahoma. And when we had talked to them last year, they had focused on some very specific use cases. Now they've expanded it across all of the government. And what's fun, and this is what I listen for a lot as one of our culture captains here at theCUBE, is how are other teams coming then back to the central source and saying, hey, can I use it for that? Or could we try this? And that's when you know you really have team buy-in. When it's just a top-down, implement this thing and look at what these dashboards do, it's not the same as creating a culture of collaboration and one that's actually going to help achieve real business value, not just the P&L, but realize a lot of different goals. And so I've been impressed that it seems like, especially as the platform's evolved, companies are really seeing that traction. I mean, of course, maybe we've just gotten a biased snapshot because that's who ended up on our stage, but like the Celonis executives were saying, people were fighting to talk on their stage because it's been so impactful for folks. And I do think it's because they always went after business value versus individual contribution. We heard that time and time again.
Yeah, I mean, I think the reason I brought that up is because I think what you're both saying really ties tightly together with what George saw on the tech side and how really the business metadata and the technical metadata coming together in a way that I don't see anybody else doing. I mean, I don't know what your thoughts are on that.
Well, what's interesting is that it's so hard to model, you know, an enterprise, like when you're all the business processes are today are entombed and entangled in the procedural code in each of the, you know, hundreds or thousands of siloed apps. And what by reading the data and then building the end-to-end map, to your point about, you know, business value, it's an end-to-end flow. And you can measure it because there are process metrics. And you know, as Karsten says, he can come in to a prospective customer and tell, are they going to be successful by, you know, does someone own an outcome? Mm-hmm. And then the software, you know, it's all, as always, people process in technology, you know, and this is a big change of a technology because it's outcomes. And so, yeah, I was coming at it from the technology side, you're coming at it from the operational side, and they both have to meet. And this is, again, one of those ones where both IT has to support the platform, but the business has to support, you know, the new outcome. And I just want to make one point about, you know, your point about the organization. It's an interesting anecdote, but the org chart was born to manage railroads because you had to have responsibility hierarchically distributed over a geographic area. But the idea was you were trying to make a machine efficient, and that's not what you're doing now. You need a new model to get an end-to-end outcome to be effective.
Yeah, I mean, I look at it, and I had the pleasure of talking to the folks from the U.S. Army and the former U.S. Army and Department of War, basically the deputy CFO of the Department of War and former director of the U.S. Army, and I think one of the things is, I would have thought the Army had, you know, and that is very process oriented. I think one of the things that it again brought back to me is that process intelligence and seeing where those optimizations have to happen before you go build an agent was just so hard, and especially in something that complex as what they're doing at
all. High risk, we're not exactly.
Yeah, I mean, it is literally life or death.
We're not making crayons here.
We're I mean, they talked about that and was, you know, again, it brings it back to a lot of the pieces, and this is why I do agree with the whole theme of this, which is you can't have AI without PI, because, you know, in the way they framed it up, just, it is the wave, and if you don't understand your processes, you're doomed. You're literally doomed to repeat them.
Well, I think it's a good point, Rob, because you know, you and I do a million shows a year, it feels like, and I think everyone talks about data and how data needs to be clean, and there's a data narrative there, but they don't talk about the process surrounding that data enough. And one of the things I've always found really illuminating about coming to this show is it's the evaluation of that layer without it. It's what it really means, right? It's one thing to say, oh, our data in this lakehouse is clean. Okay, well, what does that mean? What are you going to do with it? Right. It's nice to have nice data, but then what? And I think it's really interesting because every story we get here is always the multiple implementations, whether that's automotive manufacturing, whether that's supply chain, whether that's software development. There's examples across the portfolio of how streamlining these processes then unlocks creativity or allows the good to happen when we make a technological shift, not just for tech's sake, but for betterment's sake, for the improvement's sake. George, we were running out of time here already. I've got one final question for you. What was the most interesting, I know you had a lot of one-on-ones, what was the most interesting conversation you had this week? Not that you have to pick a favorite child, but.
Well, there was talking to the head of engineering about the replatforming they were doing for performance and scale was one thing. And then talking to some of the technical product managers, one of the things that I don't think people realize with agents, we're just beginning to talk about agents, not with, you know, RAG and just reading the latest stuff, but training them against process metrics. There are not that many companies that can do that. There are even fewer that can take the process mining exhaust. And it's like scaffolding for the agents, because if you just train them with the metrics, the rewards are too sparse, and so it's very difficult. It's training wheels for training the agents. And the point of bringing that up is, even though there are a lot of vendors who are trying to train agents now, I don't think they have the data to do it.
I agree.
Or the knowledge, the insight, I should say. Knowledge makes it sound like they're not intelligent. That's not what I'm trying to say. The insight to know the best application thereof.
Yeah.
Or the easiest point of traction, if you will, because there's, you know, AI everywhere just distracts everybody into this crazy mess, but knowing exactly which processes. And you know, one thing that I thought was actually really cool that came up today, and this may be our closing note, is the culture of collaboration between the Celonis community. They're coming together to share ideas and best practices and say, oh, this is what I learned about this. You know, they've got their champions network, they've got this partner ecosystem. And it's really different than when everybody was just secretly doing stuff to try and be more competitive. Because this collaboration not only makes us more efficient and saves money and hits that P&L that everybody cares about, it makes us more sustainable because we're not wasting power processing things we shouldn't be doing. It makes your employees feel more empowered because they have insights and able to spend their time doing the right things. And it makes teams more successful because they're driving towards a shared common goal.
One comment that we made, I think it was in the 70s and 80s, there was a big move towards making factories work efficiently end to end. And my take on the process intelligence is we're basically building build to order assembly lines for knowledge work. And that this is the intelligence. This is the intelligence to make that work with both efficiency and customization.
Yeah.
And traditionally you chose one or the other. Now you can have both.
Yeah, I thought the same thing when you're talking about things coming out of Toyota and Honda and all the auto manufacturers. In fact, we had like a plethora of auto manufacturers.
We really did.
And that was one of the comments I made to him is that's really where automation started. And it's been refined over the decades. I thought this was just great. And I had a lot of fun this week, that's for sure.
I really always enjoy this event. Everything from the branding to the food to the guest curation to sharing this week with you guys. Yeah. It is always a joy.
Well, thank you.
Yeah, so thank you both. You would be verklempt not to give a shout out to our fabulous production team. Just because you can't see them doesn't mean they're not absolutely fantastic. We've got the Henderson brothers in the back there. We've got Ken holding down the fort. We've also got Isabel and the entire Celonis team who do such a fantastic job of showing us the impact they're having, not just telling us the impact they're having and focusing on the features. It is so refreshing sitting in this seat, getting to talk to real customers, implementing and achieving real value, and more importantly, making lives better, making the world a more sustainable, incredible place. So we are all very grateful for you tuning in to our 2 days of live coverage here in beautiful Bavaria in Munich, Germany. Signing off for the last time from Celosphere, my name's Savannah Peterson. You're watching theCUBE, the leading source for enterprise tech news.